Good morning from me. So basically, we're going to be talking about benchmarking in C++. This talk is actually a primer on std chrono. And benchmarking is a practice so ubiquitous, we don't even have to give an introduction or motivation for this. But let's just quote Howard Hinant, who said that without measurement, you have a faith-based system, not a scientific theory. We're going to be dealing with the time utilities provided by and introduced by std chrono in C++ 11, which is a flexible collection of types that track time with varying degrees of precision. We can identify three workhorses for benchmarking in chrono, that is clocks, durations, and time points. And to give a definition of each one, a clock is a bundle consisting of a duration, a time point, and a function now that gets us the current time point. The origin of the clock's time point is referred to as the clock's epoch. And it's a class that contains time information. You have to know four things basically about clocks. We can call the now function to get the current time of a clock. That there are three types of clocks, steady clock, system clock, and high resolution clock. The difference among them being that a steady clock ticks in a monotonic way, and system clocks tick in a wall clock in the system way, and the high resolution clocks are usually a type def for either of the previous. Clock's tick period is the number of times it ticks per second, specified by std ratio. And the epoch of a clock is a specific point in time, the most usual being midnight of January 1st, 1970. Durations are class templates that represent time intervals. Definition of the duration class template has two template parameters. The first one, rep, is the type of the value used to represent the times, usually long. And the period is a compile time rational constant representing the number of seconds from one tick to another. The only data stored in a duration is a tick count of type rep. If rep is a floating point, then the duration can represent fractions of ticks. To give some examples, if we want to store minutes in a short data type, we write the duration of short in a ratio of 60 to 1 because there are 60 seconds in 1 minute. The same goes for milliseconds. Therein, the ratio is 1 to 1,000. There's 1 second for every 1,000 milliseconds. And there's an example also with std micro. Time points is a duration of time that has passed since the epoch of a specific clock. The class template has two template parameters again, one being the clock of the type of the clock it refers to, and the second one being the duration as the units of measurement. So timing techniques, of course, the most obvious one is a stopwatch. We can say stopwatch in a MATLAB fashion that has a tick and a tock public member functions. All we need to store is the time point that gives us the start of the timing experiment and the elapsed time. Here we can do a in-class member initialization to value initialization of the elapsed time. The member functions are all ref qualified because we don't want the NR value clock to be modified this way. And two differences between the duration and time count is that the first one returns the elapsed time in the chrono type system, the actual elapsed time, and while the second returns the count of this type. For example, it can give you the number of milliseconds that have elapsed or the number of microseconds. The use pattern for such a utility is pretty straightforward. Let's define a stall function that makes our thread sleep for 120 milliseconds. Here we see that we can use chrono literals. The MS creates milliseconds as long as we have the proper using declaration. And all we have to do is surround the code, the block we want to time, with a tick and a tock. A nice feature of this design, particularly, is that we can add the time that has passed since the previous tick-tock call pair. For example, here we always add up the time that stall one was called until we call a reset function that zeros out our elapsed time. So this allows us to find out how much time was spent printing. Also, we can see here that it's good to do timing operations or averaging or subtracting times in the chronotype system. Here I call the count function to get the actual count of the milliseconds after I have subtracted the two times. That was a nitpick suggested by Howard Heenan in a Stack Overflow question. For a less intrusive approach, we can use instrumentation. This is a popular way of doing such things, where we have an execution function and we pass here we pass our value references to the function and variadic our value references to the argument that function accepts. And this process of surrounding our callable with a tick and a tock call is done inside the measurement function. So here I use the C++17 invoke function that provides not only for callables that are called with the usual paren operator, but also for pointers to memory function and things that have a slightly different calling style. And we always have to use stood forward to preserve the value category of the callables and the arguments themselves. Again, we see the difference between the execution and the duration. The second one returns the duration in the clock in the chronotype system, while the first one fetches the count of the actual elapsed milliseconds. And the use pattern for such mechanisms is really more simple and clearer. We see here that we just have to pass the stall function to a measure structure that we instantiate with the time and the clock type we wish to have for our measurement. And we have our measurement. So there are more instrumentation techniques. I like to use lambdas for this type of work. And it's a good idea to incorporate error handling because you wouldn't want to include to your measurements a function that would fail. Here we see a C++14 generic lambda. Out of ref is a forward reference to the function being called. And the arguments are called the same way. And we use the expect of t type. The expect of t was a type of introduced by Alexandrescu, I think, at 2009 or 12. The implementation used here is by Martin Mene. So expect of t, what does is it encapsulates either value of type t or an exception. A good side effect here is that it can also encapsulate a return type of type void. You don't actually have a return type, but you can push this back in a expect of t type. What we return from such a function is a pair of the actual return type, the expected return type, or t, and the second member of the pair is the duration. To see an example of such a use case, let's define a stall two function that throws an exception. We can see here at the second branch, so you can see the pointer. No. Here, at the second branch, when calling the stall two function, it will throw an exception that will be encapsulated in the expected type. So the second branch will run, printing could not time. Now, naturally, in a benchmarking framework, you would have a method to log these things into some error states and track these executions. Of course, tools like that are easy to compose, and you can easily create more complex frameworks. Unfortunately, I don't have the time to elaborate on this, but I had a blog post posted in ISO CPP called Benchmarking in C++. What I did was creating a benchmark framework where its benchmark class would be parametrizable by the time and the clock type. And with each instance of such a benchmark object, you could run multiple experiments. That is, group things you want to time so that you can graph them together or compare them or do other stuff. Here we see that the use pattern of this code is to call run on an experiment and pass it a name, a sample size, that is how many times you want each experiment to run, the code you want to type, and the factors. Factors are what we see in the along the x-axis when we plot the experiment. It's also a good idea to have a way to serialize those things. Most used format now is JSON. I use the Python-friendly output so that I could store them as a Python dictionary and created a complementary Python script to read the output and make graphs using matplotlib. So I think that's all for me. Thank you.